Good morning.
Morning.
And welcome everybody to Guest Baptist this morning. Got a few announcements to go over. Just remember all this. All the social distance guidelines. The offering plates in the back. We do have the online giving and the text to give. I think there's a slide for that. But need any help with that? You can get with me and. Me or Ryan, either one can help you with that if you need to set up with that. Tomorrow night, the 4th, we'll have an in-depth Bible study starting at 6 o'clock. And then next Sunday, ain't that right? 10th? Next Sunday, right? Yep. Next Sunday, January 10th, Daniel Wilson will be here to preach the morning and night service. January 29th, Brother Caleb wanted us to announce and everybody to invite everybody to come out to his ordination at Pine Ridge. That's on a Friday night. So that's January 29th at 6 o'clock at Pine Ridge. Today we have the nursery available for birth to 4 years. It's actually, I don't know if we have anybody back there, but it is available if anybody needs it. I will go over the guidelines that she gave us. It's starting today, infant to 4 years. Each parent will complete a brief health questionnaire before the child enters. And the toys will be limited to hard surface, non-porous items for easy sanitation. Snacking will be closely monitored to prevent the spread of germs. And please be respectful to the current climate and refrain from exposing your children to the nursery if you have any reason to believe they are ill. And the first Sunday in February, we will have nursery for Sunday school, and that's birth to 4 years. So they can go in there in their Sunday school, and they'll be teaching them what they can. But that'll be available the first Sunday in February. Any other announcements? Did think of it? Oh, was it January 10th? Money. Belize?
Yes, next Sunday.
We had a meeting about it, but I'll remind you, if you're planning on going to Belize, you got to have your deposit next Sunday. We got to have it so we'll know so we can get that set up for the plane tickets. Anything else? Okay.
Some bad morning when it's time to Baptist Church, good to have each of you with us this morning. If you're visiting with us, we're glad you're here. But most of all, we're glad we get together this morning. Amen? Would there be any prayer requests before we go further into service? All right. Any others? Amen. Any others? All right. Remember Brother Caleb and Sister Becca, they're out this morning with COVID. We've got some others that's tested positive. We need to remember all of them. Anybody else? Yes, remember Brother Gerald. Any others? All right. Anybody else? All right. Any others? Remember this. Anybody else? All right. If not, I want you to stand up, put a smile on your face, wave at somebody, tell them you're glad they're here.
Jason Mays, if he would, open us in prayer.
Let's pray. Dear Father,
be here today. One of my favorite songs here.
Crossing the calm seas with Jesus, the disciples were getting concerned. The wind started violently blowing, but he was asleep in the stern. Does he not care that we perish? We're helpless and we're so afraid. Jesus arose when they called him, said to them, where is your faith? Because you prayed all night, because you held on with all of your might, child, your cries have awoken the Master. Your hands, it's time to rejoice, child, your cries have awoken the Master. Well, it happened without any warning, the storms of your life had begun. Seeing no hope in the distance, frightened and nowhere to run. By now your vessel is sailing, you're thinking you'll surely drown. Cried out for help from the Savior, and you know you can't give up now, because you prayed all night, cause you held on with all of your might. Child, your cries have awoken the Master, and he knows your voice. Lift your hands, it's time to rejoice. Child, your cries have awoken the Master. You're up there worried, but he's fast asleep. The wind's so deadly, the water's so deep. But you must be patient, for soon he'll bring peace. One word from his voice, soon it must cease. Because you prayed all night, because you held on with all of your might. Child, your cries have awoken the Master, and he knows your voice. Lift your hands, it's time to rejoice. Child, your cries have awoken the Master. Child, your cries have awoken the Master.
I thought that number one would surely be me. Thought I could be what I wanted to be. I thought I could build on life's sinking sand, but I can't even walk without. Lord, chapter number 22. There I am. Luke 22, we're going to begin reading there in verse number 7. Luke 22 and verse number 7. You ever had one of them messages you just didn't want to preach, Brother Dennis? I've got one this morning, and I want you to hang in with me as best you can. I want you to just find you a spot and just grab on, because this is a much-needed message in a new year. A much-needed message in a new year. Luke chapter 22, begin reading there in verse 7, if y'all would stand for reverence of the reading of God's holy, inspired, infallible word. Luke 22, verse 7, the Bible says, "Then came the day of unleavened bread, when the Passover must be killed. And he sent Peter and John, saying, 'Go and prepare us the Passover, that we may eat.' And they said unto him, 'Where wilt thou that we prepare?' And he said unto them, 'Behold, when you are entered into the city, there shall be a man meet you, bearing a pitcher of water. Follow him into the house where he entereth in, and ye shall say unto him, unto the goodman of the house, "The master saith unto thee, where is thy guest chamber, where I shall eat the Passover with my disciples?" And he shall show you a large upper room furnished. There make ready. And they went and found as he had said unto them, and they made ready the Passover." Let's pray together. Father, Lord, we love you. We thank you and praise you, God, for all your many blessings upon us. God, we thank you for the opportunity, Lord, to get to stand and share your word this morning. And Father God, though this may be a tough message, Father, I pray, Lord, that you'd give the congregation ears to listen and hearts to obey your word. And Father God, I pray, Lord, that you'd put your thoughts in my mind, your words in my mouth, Lord God, and make me nothing more than your mouthpiece in this place this day. God, we'll be careful to give you the praise, the honor, the glory, and the thanksgiving for anything that may be accomplished today. In Jesus Christ's name we pray, amen, and you may be seated this morning. As we examine this passage of Scripture, I want you to understand that as you look from Luke's point of view, you don't get the whole picture. You can find these words in also in the book of Matthew chapter 26. You'll find where they made ready the Passover. And a matter of fact, in Matthew 26:19, you'll find these words: "They made ready the Passover," and it's speaking there about the disciples. In Mark 14, verse 16, it says those exact same words: "They made ready the Passover," and it was speaking again about two disciples. And then in Luke 22:13, it says, "They made ready the Passover," and he's speaking there, of course, of Peter and John that it tells us about in verse number 8. But then you move forward and you get a glimpse of, from Matthew's point of view, you get a glimpse from Mark's point of view. In this morning, you got the glimpse from Luke's point of view about what the Last Supper looked like, what the Last Passover meal looked like, and as they prepared for that. But there's also, over in the book of John, chapter number 13, there is a little bit more to the story. So if you take all four of the Gospels and you combine all four of the Gospels, you get a good overview of what that night actually looked like. In three of the Gospels, Matthew, Mark, and Luke, it says these words: "They made ready the Passover." They made ready the Passover. So this morning, I want to share with you something that is heavy upon my heart as I prepared this week, as I sought the Lord. Lord, what would you have us preach on the first Sunday of a new year? God, what would you have us, what direction do you want us to go? the Lord just kept bringing this to my mind, and I could not escape it. It's one of those things where I thought, well, that's a good message. Maybe that's not for the first Sunday of the year. Then the Lord began to put all four of the gospel accounts together in my mind, and as I began to look at that, I saw what God was trying to tell me, so that way I could in turn tell you, and that's what we're on this morning. I want you to understand, the Bible says in three of the gospel accounts, they made ready the Passover. It gives those exact terminology in all three accounts, in Matthew and Mark and in Luke. They made ready the Passover. And this morning, I want you to put yourself there, and I know that none of us are Jewish. We don't know what it's like to make ready the Passover meal. So I'm gonna share with you some of the things that they had to do in order to make the Passover meal. I wrote down these words, and you may want to jot them down. You may not want to. It doesn't matter to me this morning. I just want you to hear what my heart's trying to say to you. They were willing despite the difficulty of the process. Number one thing that they had to do in order to make ready the Passover, first of all, the room had to be found. The room had to be found. Jesus told them here in the words that I read you from Luke 22, he told them about how to find the room that they were supposed to eat the Passover meal in. All right, well, that's a major deal, because you don't understand, you don't realize that during this time, during Jesus' day, every one of the Jews made the pilgrimage to Jerusalem in order to eat the Passover meal. And most theologians tell us, and scholars that are far smarter than I am, that they were a little over 2.7 million people that flooded the streets of Jerusalem during the week of Passover. So finding a room was not an easy task, all right? Finding a room was not an easy task. Every hotel was sold out. Every place of business was just packed with people. And so finding this room was tough. It was a job within itself, but Jesus took care of that. He said, you're going to find a man toting a pitcher of water, which I've got right over here. Y'all can't see it. Let me get it out here. He said, you're going to see a man that's toting a pitcher of water. He said, I want you to follow him. Wherever he goes, you go. And when you go into the house, you're going to ask the goodman of the house, show me the upper room or the guest chamber. That way, and it's going to be a large upper room, and it's going to be furnished. Okay. So the first thing they had to do is they had to find the room. Well, that wasn't real hard. Jesus made it pretty easy for them. He said, you follow the man that's got the pitcher of water. But the second thing they had to do is they had to then go into the room and prepare that room for the Passover meal. They had to go in and prepare that room. Now, this was a guest chamber. This was a guest chamber in a house of somebody that they did not know. Amen? Y'all with me so far? Some of you ain't, but maybe y'all still hung over from New Year's Eve. I don't know. Here's the thing. They had to follow in, or had to go into a house. They had to follow a man with a pitcher. They had to go into a house. Then they had to go in, and they had to prepare that room for the Passover. This was a guest chamber in the house of somebody that they did not know. Now, I don't know about you. I don't know about how you are, but very seldom do we use the guest chamber at our house. All right? The rest of my house is immaculate because I got a wife what's got OCD. But I would refer to our upper room, our playroom, our attic room as our guest chamber, because that's somewhere we very seldom go. And when we do go, it's usually Isaac that goes, and he's usually got a mama with him, and man, it's destroyed. Amen? Y'all know what I'm talking about. Well, this guy's no different than what we are. That guest chamber had to be cleaned. Somebody say amen.
That guest chamber had cobwebs, no doubt, all over in the windowsills. That guest chamber, no doubt, had a half inch of dirt on the floor that they had to be swept up. I bet you that thing was nasty. Amen. And so these guys, they despite the difficulty of the process, they were willing to go and do what Jesus said do. He said, you're going to go and you're going to find a man with a pitcher. You're going to follow him. Then you're going to go to the house. You're going to find the home, the room where we're going to have it. And then you're going to prepare to receive the Passover meal. So they had to go in and they had to get their brooms out and they had to start sweeping out and they had to start cleaning cobwebs out and they had to start making sure that the Bible says that the room was furnished. They had to dust out the cushions that they were going to sit on. They had to do all of these things. Then but here's the thing of it is they didn't know this guy and they didn't know what kind of background he come from. They didn't know how clean he was. We don't by the account in the Bible. But I'm just imagining, you know, they're having to clean. They're having to do all these things. Then there's something else that has to take place before you can have the Passover meal. Leaven has to be searched out in the house. Because you cannot eat the Passover meal anywhere if there's leaven in the house. And you say, what's leaven? Well, it's kind of like yeast. It's kind of like what we'd think of as yeast or even baking soda, something of that nature, something that gets the process of bread rising going. That's what leaven is. But in Scripture, leaven is equated to sin. You know, when the Bible says that a little bit of leaven leaveneth the whole loaf, it's equated to sin. And so before they could receive the Passover meal, these disciples had to go in. They had to sweep the room. They had to clear out the room. They had to dust out the cushions. And then they had to start searching for leaven in the house. Well, there's a story there. There's a picture there that we need to receive in 2021. On the first Sunday of the new year, we need to receive that because there's such a great picture there. We need to search our hearts. Amen. High and low. Amen. We need to look in every corner and every nook in our lives and say, is there any leaven in here? Is there any leaven in my heart? Is there any sin in my heart? Is there any sin in this place? After we've swept it out, after we've cleaned it out, we begin to search and say, is there leaven here? Because if there's leaven here, then it's not worthy for the Lord to sit in this place. Y'all get where I'm going? So they had to clean out the room. They had to search for the leaven in the house. And something was amazing about this whole scenario. Once they searched out the leaven, they found the leaven. They had to take it outside of the house and burn it. Not only do we need to get rid of the sin in our lives, we need to take it out and destroy it. Amen. Not just cast it out and say, hey, I'll pick that up later whenever I feel like it. Amen. Because that's what we as Baptists do. We come to an altar and we'll pour our hearts out to the Lord and we'll confess things that's in our lives and things that we don't want anybody else to know about. And then we'll say, well, we're just going to set that over there to the side and we'll pick it up when we're feeling better. But with 11, you were to cast it out and you were to burn it outside of the house and destroy it. What a picture for the new year that we're going into. Y'all understand that I'm saying to you this morning that it was a difficult process for them to make ready the Passover. It's a difficult process. I'm not done yet. Somebody better say, thank you, Jesus. Then they had to go out and they had to gather bitter herbs. Bitter herbs to eat with their Passover meal. And it was to remind them of the bitterness of being in bondage and the bitterness of being in chains in Egypt. It was to remind them of how the taskmasters took advantage of them and would whip them as they made the bricks and all of those things during their time in bondage. They had to go out and they had to gather bitter herbs. Then they had to make a nut and a fruit paste. taste. They'd take nuts and they'd take fruit and they'd begin to grind that down and make a paste out of it to enjoy the Passover meal with. They had to have bitter herbs and then they had to have a nut and a fruit paste made. See, there's a lot to preparing for the Passover. It's a difficult process to prepare for the Passover. But every one of the gospel accounts says they made ready the Passover. They not only did they have to make the nut and the fruit paste, the bitter herbs, the room had to be cleaned and searched out and all of those things. But then they had to go and they had to purchase a lamb that was without spot, without blemish. That lamb had to be taken to the temple. And once that lamb was taken to the temple, you say, why did they take the lamb to the temple to be inspected? And then it had to be slaughtered outside of the temple. And as they slaughtered that lamb, that all of the blood had to be caught in a basin underneath. And then the priest would take the blood and he would throw it on the burnt offering. All right? He'd throw it on the fire. Boy, this is a hassle, ain't it? Amen. Boy, I'm going to just say something right now. I may just set to the side and go off on a tangent here for just a second. I'm glad we ain't got to do that stuff no more, ain't you? I'm glad the Passover lamb was slain once and for all for me. Amen. I'm glad that I don't have to worry about catching blood in a basin and going out and picking bitter herbs. I'm glad I don't have to make a nut and a fruit paste in order to have that. I'm glad I don't have to do all of those things that these old boys had to do. But this morning, I want you to understand it was a difficult process, and these guys were willing despite the difficulty of the process. They went out and they had to took their lamb. They had it inspected at the temple. They had to slaughter it at the temple. They had to catch the blood in the basin at the temple. It had to be thrown onto the offering of burnt offerings at the temple. And then they had to take it home after they had dressed it, after they had skinned it and slaughtered it and dressed it, and after they'd done all of those things. Then they had to bring it back to the place, and they had to build a fire. And then they'd roast the lamb. And then they would make unleavened bread in order to have the Passover meal. So when you see those five words, they made ready the Passover, this is a big deal. Amen? This is a huge deal. They made ready the Passover. It's just five little words. And you'll walk right past it. You'll just stroll right on by it and they'll think, well, cool, they made ready the Passover. It's not like they went down to Chick-fil-A and ordered a platter. Amen? Now, that's easy. We've got things easy in our society today. And we think, well, we'll just skim right over passwords like that. But listen to me. They were willing despite the difficulty of the process. Second thing that I want you to understand about these guys and them making ready the Passover, speaking here about the disciples. You know, and I want to make something clear to you this morning. Verse 8 of Luke 22 tells us, it names Peter and John as those that were to go make ready the Passover. And I want to make something very clear to you. This, it took everything they both had to make ready the Passover. It was a difficult process. It was tough. But do you know what Peter and John was saying to the Lord? Even though it's a dirty, difficult task, you've asked us, so Lord, you're worthy. Amen. Well, let's move past the difficulty of the process and let's look at this. They were willing despite the dirt of preparation. You say, Brother John, I don't understand what you meant, the dirt of preparation. There were cobwebs in the house. There was dust. There was dirt in the house. And no doubt as they got down on their hands and their knees in that floor, scrubbing that floor, getting it ready for the Passover, no doubt they got dirt on their knees. No doubt they got dirt in their eyes. And as they were sweeping down the cobwebs, no doubt some of them fell into their hair. Despite the dirt of the preparation, they were willing. Despite, listen, as you move through this, despite the smell of the bitter herbs on their hands, they still went out and picked them. Despite the elbow grease that it took to form the fruit and the nut paste, despite of how hard they had to work, they were saying, Lord, it may be difficult and it may be dirty, but Lord, you're worthy. Despite the hassle and the nastiness of skinning the lamb and catching the blood in a basin. And you say, Brother John, what do you mean by hassle? They had to do all of this at the temple. They had to tote everything they needed to slaughter that lamb up there to the temple. They had to take everything with them. They had to take the lamb with them. They had to take the knife with them. They had to take the basin with them in order to slaughter that lamb at the temple. And they had to have it inspected first. I'm talking about this was a hassle. How many of you's ever skinned a deer? That's nasty, ain't it? Amen? Some of you need to learn. It's nasty. Well, they're skinning this lamb at the temple. They're getting blood on them. And that blood dripping down into that basin as they begin to skin that lamb, and as they begin to take the outer coat off that lamb, but they were willing, despite the dirt of preparation, because they said, Lord, you're worthy. You're worthy. And let me tell you something this morning. He's still worthy. He's still worthy. Despite the dirt of preparation, you take yourself and look in this and look at what it meant. They had to come back home after they had done the nastiness and had the hassle over at the temple. They had to come back to this place where the upper room was. They had to go out and they had to gather wood and build a fire. And they didn't have a Zippo. Amen? They didn't even have a Bic. They had to build a fire. This was not an easy process. It's a difficult process. And how many of you have ever built a fire and not got the smell of smoke on you? So they had the dirt of the wood as they brought the wood and they laid it down. They had the sweat, no doubt, as they began to rub that wood together to make that fire. They had the sweat of once they got the fire built, then they had the smell of smoke all over them. So they got sweat and blood and tears, no doubt. They've got all of these things going on, but yet they're saying, Lord, you're worthy. I'm willing today, despite the dirt of preparation, to get that dirt on me because, Lord, you're worthy. I'm willing this morning, despite the difficulty of the process. Peter and John are named, and y'all, we could stop and just camp out there for just a minute. They knew what it was to prepare the Passover meal. So did the other 10 disciples. Do you hear me? That would have been at one of them points that you know, might have tried to hide. Lord Jesus, don't pick me. There's some of you sitting here this morning that you're saying, Lord Jesus, don't pick me. Don't pick me. You're trying to hide in behind somebody. You're trying to say, oh, no, don't pick me. I can't go on the mission field, Lord. I can't preach your word, Lord. I can't study your word. I can't teach a Sunday school class. And you're trying your best to hide in behind somebody, and you're saying, no, Lord Jesus, don't pick me. Peter and John were given a job, and despite the difficulty of the process, despite the dirt of preparation, they were willing because he is worthy. How many of you this morning are willing because he's worthy? How many of you are willing because he's worthy? Last thing I wrote down in for the dirt of the process or the dirt of preparation is they had to smell not only of the smoke, the sweat, the blood, all of the things that they had in the preparation. But there's nobody sitting here this morning. Cooking always has a smell. Amen. My sister used to work at Hardee's in Rainsville back when I was a kid. And it was there when I was a kid. But my sister used to work there. And I can remember she'd come home and she'd smell like Hardee's. It stunk. Not that Hardee's stinks. You get what I'm saying? But all of those different smells accumulating on one place, it stinks. Amen? First thing my sister would do when she'd walk in the house is she'd go to the shower. And she'd get rid of all of that smell for the day. There's those that are saying, Lord Jesus, don't pick me. But then I'm praising God this morning for the Peter and Johns that'll say, despite the difficulty of the process, despite the dirt of preparation, I'm willing. I'm willing. Are you one of those? Are you one of those that are willing to get a little stink on you? Story's not over. Turn with me if you would, and I'm going to be as quick as I possibly can. You know, I know I could say 10 words and I'm testing some of you's patience. I don't want to test your patience this morning. It's the last thing I want to do in a new year. But I want you to understand that that's not the full picture. John 13, verse 1, it says, now before the feast of the Passover, when Jesus knew that his hour was come, that he should depart out of this world unto the Father, having loved his own which were in the world, he loved them unto the end. And supper being ended, the devil, having now put into the heart of Judas Iscariot, Simon's sons, to betray him, Jesus, knowing that the Father had given all things into his hands and that he was come from God and went to God, he rises from supper, laid aside his garments, took a towel, and girded himself. After that he poureth the water into the basin and began to wash the disciples' feet and to wipe them with a towel wherewith he was girded. Y'all know the story. Who was it that prepared the Passover meal? Let me make sure I'm telling you. Peter and John. John. Do you know that the book of John is the only place that you have this recorded? See, because John remembered something else about that night. He remembered something else about that night that the others failed to write down. Do you know why? Because he was one of the ones that was willing, despite the difficulty of the process, despite the dirt of preparation, he was willing. But see, let me share something with you. Before they were to ever eat the Passover meal, there was something left out. Ryman, come up here. If you ain't left. Ryman said, I'm not good at getting up in front of people. I said, you don't have to say nothing. Take your shoes off, please. Socks, roll up your britches. What John remembers is that he said, Lord, I'm willing, despite the difficulty of the process. What John remembers is that I was willing, despite the dirt of preparation. They were to never eat the Passover meal till their feet were clean. So when those five words where he says they made ready the Passover, they made ready the Passover, all except for one thing. All except for one thing. The Bible says, and it says it right there in John 13. The Bible says right there, in John 13, that Jesus stood up at the end of supper and he girded himself with a towel. Why did Jesus wait till the end of supper? Maybe Jesus is waiting to see who's willing. Jesus rose up from there and he took his pitcher of water. You can read it in John 13. And he began to pour over the disciples' feet. And then he got down there and he began to wash those disciples' feet. And the Bible says then he dried them off with a towel that he had girded around himself. Maybe Jesus was waiting to see who was willing. You say, Brother John, I don't get your point. Y'all ready for this? They were willing despite the difficulty of the process. They were willing despite the dirt of preparation. But they wasn't willing to get the dirt of people on them. They weren't willing to get the dirt of people on them. It's funny that John remembers that. It's funny to me that John remembers I wasn't willing. Lord, you's worthy of the dirt I got on me at the killing the Passover lamb. You was worthy of the dirt of cleaning up the place, but you wasn't worthy of the dirt of people. A couple of years ago, everybody sitting in here probably, some of you may not, a couple of years ago, Lord, give me a vision. Vision 2020. And I said on multiple occasions, as I tried to cast the vision for the church, that if we'd invite 2,020 people to our church from 2018 or 2017, whatever, whenever it was, to the end of year 2020 that God would give us 109 baptized. And I said to you that if we do our part, He'd do His. When we started a couple of years ago, I did the math. I sat down and done the math and of who was actively coming to our church. And of those that were actively in attendance in our church during that time, all that anybody would have had to do is invite 13 people for us to reach 2020. So what I did, within the first 2 to 3 weeks, I don't remember which, of me issuing the vision, I invited my 13. I wrote my 13 down. I put them in that notebook that's sitting up there on the pulpit this morning. And I'm not telling you that I didn't invite other folks to church. I did. I just didn't write them down. Because here's the thing. You've got to be willing. You've got to be willing to get the dirt of people on you. The sad matter of the fact is this, that over half of our church didn't invite a single person. We're willing to show up. We're willing to show up. We're willing to sing in the choir. We're willing to put money in the offering plate. We're willing to do whatever needs to be done except that. Except get the dirt of somebody on you. The final tally. Six 618 people were invited to our church. That's awesome. That is 30.59% of what we were supposed to. Less than a third. We baptized 29, which was 27.52%, so within 3% of what we did, God did. John remembers he wasn't willing to get the dirt of people on him. And then he shows us what Jesus did. He starts out in that scripture and he says he loved his own to the very end. He loved his own to the very end. Maybe Jesus was waiting to see who was willing. Maybe Jesus was watching to see who was wholehearted. I started to name this message the case of the half-hearted holy men. You know why? Because they was willing to do everything but that. I bet you anything. Who was it that prepared the Passover meal? Peter and John. John records this, but you think about what Peter just says in those next few verses. Lord, you ain't gonna wash my feet. Not my feet, Lord. Not my feet. And Jesus said, if I don't wash your feet, you ain't got no part with me. He said, then not my feet only, Lord. Wash all over me. Don't you feel like that this morning that Peter and John must have gotten down at a point right there when Jesus bowed down at their feet and began to wash their feet? They thought, oh, we're willing to do everything but this. Do you know what? I'm going to share with you something. Real ministry is messy. Real ministry is messy. Sometimes you know things that you don't want to know. Sometimes you have to try to lead somebody and try to help them and you think, my goodness, how did you get yourself in this position? How did you get yourself in this mess? But you know what? You got to love them anyway. And you've got to say, I'm willing to get the dirt on me anyway. I'm willing to crawl under a trailer anyway. I'm willing to get up in the middle of the night and go listen to you anyway. Oh, why? Because I'm willing to get the dirt of people on me because He's worthy. He's worthy. Oh, when you look at those five words they made ready the Passover, don't ever forget this. Don't ever forget that it was a difficult process. Don't ever forget that it was a dirty, foul-smelling process. But don't ever forget that they wasn't willing to do. Get the dirt of people. Ryman, thank you, brother. I'm going to give you a hug and you can go sit down. I love you. Here, you need that. True ministry is messy. But it's time we start investing in people. It's time we started investing in people. I'm going to share with you, and none of them's here this morning, so you can tell them when they come back that I talked about them during service. I don't remember when it was. I don't. It's been a few years ago now. But Jacob Mitchell invited a young boy to our church named Yvonne Salvador. And the Salvador family came into our church, and I don't remember. I think it was 2-3 weeks. I don't remember which. One Sunday, A-Rod came up to the altar and she was right over here. I'll never forget it. A-Rod said, I need to be saved. I prayed with A-Rod. She got saved that morning. That Tuesday or Thursday of that same week, she got saved on Sunday. I don't remember if it was Tuesday or Thursday. Yvonne could tell you. But Yvonne got saved at school. Same week. That next Sunday, George came to the altar and he said, I want what my kids have got. And I said, I explained to him about salvation. He said, yeah, I want that. I prayed with George. George accepted Jesus as his Savior. Then, the next week, the very next week, Miss Teresa come to the altar. She didn't speak English. You know the Holy Spirit speaks Spanish. She didn't speak no English. A-Rod got down beside of her. I went over her and said, can I help y'all pray about something? She said, mama's wanting to get saved, and her mama would say something, and then A-Rod would tell me, and then she'd tell her. I led Teresa to the Lord in this altar through an interpreter. Finer, more faithful people you will not find. All because one young boy was willing to invite somebody to church. Not long, I don't remember, it's been a year or two, something passes by. Lervin gives his heart to Jesus. Y'all looking at somebody that baptized a whole family. And everybody that comes on Wednesday night will testify to the fact that George is still praying for the rest of his family. Goodness. But you got to be willing to get the dirt on you. The dirt of people. Because everybody don't look like you. Everybody don't talk like you. Everybody don't smell like you. But you got to be willing to get some dirt on you. Why? Because he's worthy. Just take for one instant. And if you're a racist, I'm fixing to make you itch in places you didn't know you had. Just think for one instant, if because they didn't look like us, we said, no, y'all not welcome here. Just think for one instant that if we said, there's a Hispanic church down the road. No. I stopped one time at a man's house right up the road from here, and that was well before I got my son, my youngest. And I invited him to church, and he looked at me, and he said, would I be welcome there? And I looked at him, and I puzzled look on my face because I can't hide my expressions. And I said, I don't know what you mean. He said, well, sir, I'm black. And I said to him, if you ain't welcome there, then I ain't welcome there. And I'm the pastor. He said, but you ain't black. I said, we all the same color on the inside. Amen. And Jesus died for all of us. But let me ask you this morning. Let me, and I just want you to answer just between you and God this morning. Are you willing to get the dirt of people on you? People don't look like you, don't act like you, don't smell like you, because I'm going to promise you something. There are probably more than 200 families in Fife that are just like George and Teresa were. And you say, what do you mean just like them? Are they Hispanic? No. They're just like them in the fact that they're lost and undone without God. But you know what? Those 200 families have hope. Because there's some men and there's some women that's willing to get some dirt on them. Y'all bow with me. Y'all get us a song ready to play, Brother John. Lord, I love you this morning. And God,